sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, shining as the sun. We've no less days to sing God's praise than when to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
Again, family, thank you so much for the privilege of being a part of Mr. Ralph's Celebration of Life service. We've gathered here this afternoon to honor the memory and to celebrate the life of a good man, Ralph Lee Bass. On Saturday, it was Mr. Ralph's time, and he was released from the earthly bonds that have held him, and at that very moment, he looked on the face of his Savior, Jesus Christ. I can only imagine the homecoming of all of those who have gone on before him. Can you imagine? Scriptures tell us that for the believer, that to be absent from the body is to be present with Almighty God. And I believe beyond a shadow of a doubt that my friend Mr. Ralph has already walked on those streets that we're told are paved with gold. Family, I want you to listen to words of comfort. When King David penned these words, they brought comfort to him. He said, "The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. And he makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters, and he restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yes, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you're with me. Your rod, your staff, they comfort me. And you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." On behalf of the Bass family, I want to thank you for your presence here today. I want to thank you for all the calls, the cards, the food, and the random acts of love and kindness that have been extended to this precious family and to Mr. Ralph during his illness and his ultimate passing. A special thank you to the State Employees Credit Union Hospice House, staff and management, for their amazing care, their amazing compassion that were extended to Mr. Ralph and this precious family during his final hours here on earth. And I have the privilege of sharing with you something which this family has experienced something that a lot of people don't experience. There was a young man by the name of Terry who was their nurse, or Mr. Ralph's nurse, on Saturday when he made his graduation to glory. And Terry Ingram penned this poem, and I want to share it with you now. The hands I used to hold you tight, though, excuse me, through the years as we grew older, the hands that toiled and worked so hard are slowing, growing colder. My body knows just what to do. This process they call dying, my brain and heart, they need that blood. How long till they stop trying? And the room grows dark. The sounds grow faint. I strain to see your face. The room grows dark. I do suppose that I may clearly see God's grace. These hands reach now to wipe your tears that fall upon the floor. And I ask you not to cry for me. For soon I'll hold my Savior's hand, and my tears will be no more. My breath is light. My lips grow dry. You offer water for my comfort. This body needs no food or drink. Those things are for the living. All I need as my time grows near is the precious love that you're giving. And this process is old as time. The price for birth is death. And you notice how my chest now rises, working for each breath. If the body fights on, doing what it can, how can breaths remain? Comfort comes, endorphins surge to spare me from the pain. And this body I no longer need. I cherished it for a while, and if your eyes could see the place I see, I know that you would surely smile. To say I'm losing my battle now is wrong. Truth be told, I'm winning. I leave you now, just for a while, to start my new beginning. Let's pray. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, please comfort this precious family. Father, as we go through this special time of remembrance and celebration of Mr. Ralph, I pray, Father, that your name would be glorified and that his life would simply be celebrated. Please comfort Lisa and Roxanne and this entire family and his dear friends as we honor your name, celebrate his life, and we lay it all at the foot of the cross. Thank you, Father, for the assurance of where Mr. Ralph is right now, and that is with you. You bless us now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Flower, just a
sang that was my daddy's favorite song. Played that at his funeral. I'm getting myself together here just a moment. A life that spanned 88 years. The year was 1933, and in the midst of the Great Depression, a baby boy was born to Redden and Irene Bass. Who could have imagined that this little baby boy would witness such incredible changes in this world? Things that we now take for granted. He actually witnessed their beginnings. He lived through the Great Depression, a world war, the Korean conflict, the arms race, Vietnam, two desert wars, major changes in our American culture. He saw us go from oil lamps to LED bulbs, radios to handheld computers and smartphones, from wood stoves to microwave ovens, and we're in Johnston County. I know we're deep in Johnston County, so you'll understand what I'm about to say. And we went from toting water to simply turning on the tap. When he was a child, Roxanne, information moved around the world at a snail's pace. Oh, but Lisa, by his 88th year, information traveled around the world at the speed of light. Great changes have occurred in this world. However, I believe the greatest change that occurred is the day that Mr. Ralph claimed Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior in his forgiving grace. It's been said many times, and I've said it myself, and you've probably said it yourself, that we preach our own funeral by the life that we have lived, and Mr. Ralph Bass did just that. A man of character, a man of integrity, and a man that demonstrated his commitment and his determination throughout his life. Family, I believe that the words of King David found in Psalm 26 could have been spoken by Ralph Bass himself. Listen, vindicate me, O Lord. For I have walked in my integrity, and I have trusted in the Lord without wavering. Prove me, O Lord, and try me. Test my heart and my mind. For your steadfast love is before my eyes, and I walk in your faithfulness. Mr. Ralph lived a life of purpose. He lived a life of integrity, worth, and he leaves behind a legacy of respect, of hard work, of compassion, of truthfulness, of loyalty, and of love. And just as we are born, we will die. And the scriptures tell us that there are some beautiful things that occur. And I want you to listen to the words found in Ecclesiastes, the third chapter, as it paints a portrait of our human existence when it says, to everything there's a season, and a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die. A time to plant, a time to pluck what is planted, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to break down, a time to build up, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, and a time to cast away stones, and a time to gather stones, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to gain, a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, and a time of love and a time of hate, a time of war and a time of peace. What profit has the worker from that in which he labors? I've seen the God-given task with which the sons of men are to be occupied. Family, Lisa, Roxanne, family, this is what I want you to take home with you. This is what I want you to remember forever, ever, until you see him again. In the 11th verse of the third chapter of Ecclesiastes, it says this: and he has made everything beautiful in its time. And Ralph Bass was a part of the beauty that God created. You know, when Mr. Ralph was a young man, he demonstrated the depth of his character and his dedication and his strength and his integrity when he willingly signed a blank check made out to the United States of America, up to and including his own life, when he proudly served in the United States Army. We're going to see that in just a few moments, a recognition of his service. Pastor Ralph was blessed with two amazing girls, Roxanne and Lisa. And he loved his girls. He didn't always agree with his girls, but he loved them. The grandsons came along, and I'm telling you, if you think that he loved Roxanne and Lisa, boy, when those grandsons came along, boy, that love expanded to include them in that Papa Ralph routine. There's no question about it. And when the great-grandchildren, oh my, that was a great day in his life to be a great-granddaddy. There's just no doubting it. An overwhelming fact that Ralph Bass loved his family. And although he wasn't blood kin, there are four people that have been as close to Ralph as any blood could be, and that's Kathy Sellers Wheeler, Shirley Lane, and Charles and Donna Flanagan. Oh, we can't leave out the fur babies, Molly and Trooper. Don't you think it interesting that this man had the capacity to love? He loved his family without doubt, but he also had the capacity to love others and to love God's creation. He just amazing. Personal story. If you get bored, raise your hand. I'm not going to change what I'm doing. I'll just know you're bored. Mr. Ralph had been nurturing a couple of Canada geese. And the circumstances presented themselves that he was no longer able to take care of those geese. Circumstances changed. Lisa was talking to Shirley. Shirley talked to my wife. And the next thing you know, we have two geese on our pond. Well, you know, I didn't go over there and grab the goose and turn it upside down to see if it was male or female. I just assumed both of them were male. So we gave them pretty names. Cecil and Henry. Come to find out, Cecil was Cecilia. What I'm getting to is this. Ralph Bass had worked with those geese until one of them, Cecil, that is, I could bend down and hold corn in my hand, and Cecil would come up and peck the corn out of my hand. Nat would tell Shirley. Shirley would tell Lisa. Lisa would say, tell Mr. Ralph. And he said, yeah, I used to do that. I taught him that. But what was really interesting is that when this tightwad bought a trash can full of deer corn, and we kept the deer fed. Of course, their neighbors would come, you know, and all of a sudden the pond is full of geese. And the neighbor didn't get too excited when they all, 37 or 40 of them, came up and dropped their little souvenirs all over everywhere. But Cecil would be hungry, and she would come up the ramp. She would get to the back door. Roger, she'd take that little bent, little crooked little nose she had, and she'd go. That was for us to get up and go feed her. So one of us would go, and we'd spread corn. Now, she would have her own little pile of corn, and Henry was over here acting all stuck up. And so we'd just fling some out there, and he'd peck two or three and look, peck two or three and look. Learned a lot about the Canada geese because of that experience. Ralph even came out to the house, and he was able to see them, and he was so excited that they had a beautiful home that they could do. And we were excited that Mr. Ralph had shared that part of his life with us. And he had some other loves in his life as well. He loved tinkering in the shop. He liked working on different projects. He liked working in the yard. That was great joy for him. You know, and when one of his girls or his grandsons would be there to help, well, that was just a little piece of heaven. I would do Ralph an injustice if I didn't tell this story. And you grand boys, you know exactly what I'm about to say. Ralph was all about tradition. He loved family. And the very first grandson that brought the very first girlfriend home for the Christmas celebration, Ralph would always know that. So what would Ralph do? Ralph would go and purchase a pair of ladies' underwear. Red. You getting the picture that Ralph kind of liked red? Red underwear. You got this now. This is a girl who has no idea what's going to happen, and the grandsons have been sworn to secrecy on the fear of death. So here this pitiful, scared, overwhelmed young girl. And she gets this package, and it's given to her with such grace and dignity. And she rips it open, and there's a pair of red drawers. And a part of that is when you get it, you got to put them on over your clothes. Now, I know it happened because I saw pictures. That was Ralph Bass. He thoroughly enjoyed that. He connected with his boys. Any of you girls here had to wear the drawers? Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Don't look up. Don't look up. I thought that was beautiful. Can you imagine? But the boys still seem to be able to keep a girlfriend. Of course, they never spoke of it. No, that quickly became a tradition at the Bass household. Another thing that Mr. Ralph enjoyed was a flea market or a yard sale. He'd spend hours perusing through those treasures that were there before him. If you look at Ralph Bass and you think about his life, how would you measure a successful life? Ralph Bass have a successful life? I believe that he did. I love what Ralph Waldo Emerson said. He said he has achieved success who has lived well, laughed often, and loved much, who has gained the respect of intelligent men and the love of little children, who has filled his niche and accomplished his task and has left this world better than he found it, who has looked for the best in others and has given the best that he had, whose life was an inspiration and whose memory is a benediction. Successful? No doubt about it. Mr. Ralph loved what he did, and he did what he loved, and I would tell you, he loved God first, then his family, and then anything that was left. He did everything that he could with passion and with courage. I want to share something with you, family. These are words of comfort. Jesus told his disciples that he would be leaving, and he left these words of comfort, and I believe because we know where Ralph is today, I believe that they add comfort to our lives in the 14th chapter of John when it says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God? You believe also in me, for in my Father's house are many mansions. And if it were not so, I would have told you. And I go and prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Roxanne, Lisa, family, I am satisfied of one thing. Mr. Ralph's already moved in to his heavenly mansion. And I don't know if there's a pond there, and I don't know if there are geese there. But I know if they are, he's all up on it, training one of them to eat corn out of his hand. Can you imagine heavenly corn and a heavenly goose eating out of his hand? I know I'm stretching the metaphor, but work with me. Those streets that are paved with gold. Thank you, Father. Family, I want you to imagine, if you will, of Mr. Ralph stepping on shore and finding it heaven. Of taking hold of a hand and finding that it's God's hand. Of breathing in new air and feeling invigorated. feeling immortal as he looks on the face of his Savior, Jesus Christ. Mr. Ralph lived a life that made a difference. He lived his commitments. He demonstrated his integrity, his faith in action, and he did it every single day. And when all is said and done, our life here on earth, when it comes to an end, what will matter? I want you to listen to these words. Ready or not, someday it's all going to come to an end. And there will be no more sunrises, no minutes, hours, or days, and all the things that you collected, whether treasured or forgotten, will pass to someone else. And your wealth, your fame, and your temporal power will shrivel to irrelevance. And it will not matter what you were owed or what you owned. Your grudges, your resentments, your frustrations, and jealousies will finally disappear. So too, your hopes, your ambitions, your plans, your to-do lists will expire. And the wins and losses that once seemed so very important will simply fade away. And it won't matter where you came from or what side of the tracks you lived on at the end. It won't matter whether you were beautiful or brilliant. Now, I'm stop right there. Girls, you know Daddy would say he was both beautiful and brilliant. So we got that established. Everybody good? This is yes. This is no. Okay. All right. Even your gender or skin color will be irrelevant. So what will matter? How will your days be valued, and how will they be measured? What will matter is not what you bought, but what you built. Not what you got, but what you gave. And what will matter is not your success, but your significance. And what will matter is not what you learned, but what you taught. And what will matter is every act of integrity, compassion, courage, or sacrifice that enriches, empowers, or encourages others to emulate your example. And what will matter is how many people will feel a lasting sense of loss when you're gone. What will matter is not your memories, but the memories of those who loved you. And what will matter is how long you will be remembered, by whom and for what. Lisa, Roxanne, living a life that matters doesn't happen by accident. It's not a matter of circumstance. You see, it's a matter of choice. And Mr. Ralph made a choice to live his life to make a difference. As we close this celebration of life service, boy, I want to share the words of a beautiful poem that speaks to the heart of Ralph Bass's dear family. And these encouraging words will sustain you for the days to come. And it's called Letting Go. The angels gathered near your bed, so very close to you, for they knew the pain and suffering that you were going through. And I thought about so many things as I held tightly to your hand. Oh, how I wish that you were strong and happy once again, but your eyes were looking homeward to that place beyond the sky where Jesus held his outstretched arms. It was time to say goodbye. And I struggled with my selfish thoughts, for I wanted you to stay, so we could walk and talk again like we did just yesterday. Oh, but Jesus knew the answer, and I knew he loved you so. So I gave to you life's greatest gift, Daddy. I gave you the gift of letting go. Roxanne, Lisa, Shirley, Kathy, grandsons, family, I encourage you to embrace this man's legacy, to emulate his faith, to demonstrate his character and integrity. And just as Mr. Ralph did, you pass it on to a new generation. The fact is clear. As long as you live, Ralph Bass and the legacy that he lived will live on in you. Because those that we love are never really gone. For we hold those memories dear in our hearts. see them in everything that we do. And their love is everywhere. And their influence, well, it never dies. To God be the glory. Would you please get a hymn book and turn to page 2? We are going to sing How Great Thou Art. I believe there are 4 verses. We're going to sing all 4 verses. You in a Southern Baptist church, we'd sing the first, second, last, but since I'm covering for Mr. Eric, I will we'll go all 4 verses. Somebody smile. Okay. Would you stand to your feet, please, in honor of Mr. Ralph? Thank you. please slide back the floor of heaven and pour out your comfort and your grace and your strength. And Father, I thank you for Mr. Ralph's witness, the love of his family, the love of friends, for your creation, and for his steadfast example of love and commitment before you. Oh, Father God, please comfort. Comfort our hearts as we learn to adjust to life without him. And in the days and the weeks and the months ahead, as we anticipate that happy reunion, when we too shall see your face. Oh, Father God, for Roxanne, for Lisa, for this entire family. Oh, Lord, please pour out your anointing of strength and comfort. And once again, Lord, thank you for allowing us to be been a part of this amazing man's life and legacy. To God be the glory. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Earth is
everyone except the family please stand?